In Galatians chapter 5, verse 6, we referred to this passage without quoting the whole verse frequently. The last part of this verse says, faith which worketh by love. Faith which worketh by love. Well, many people would believe and they would say, this is God's love if you know, if you believe, if you, as soon as you understand and get developed and get just meditate on it and focus on it and let it get big in you that God loves you, then you can have faith in God. And that's how people very often preach it. Well, there's an important aspect to that. As you understand God loves you, God desires the best for you. Love will desire the best. 1 Corinthians 13 talks about God's love and talks about God's love in us. That love, when we're walking in love, will desire the best for people. But one of the fruit of the Spirit, the first one listed, the first one mentioned, right here in Galatians 5, coming down to verse 22, is love. Well, the fruit of the Spirit, certainly that's God's Spirit, that's the Holy Spirit, but it's you. The characteristics of God in you were to walk in love. That's what Paul wrote. He wrote this to the Galatians, but he also wrote the Ephesians. And in Ephesians, in chapter 5, he said to walk in love as dear children. Verse 1 says, be followers or imitators of God. Imitate. As dear children, children should imitate their father. Even in the natural, children imitate their parents. Very often you see young children, they're wanting to wear daddy's hat. The little girl is wanting to put on mama's shoes. And if mama wears makeup, the little girl's got that lipstick. You know, you come into the bedroom or you come into the bathroom or wherever, and she's got that lipstick out, painting it on her face. Because mama does that. She's wanting to wear mama's shoes. She's wanting to wear mama's necklace. And the little boy is wanting to wear daddy's shoes and daddy's hat. So in the natural, little children are wanting to do things that they see their parents do. That's why it's good to be the right example, because they're going to want to take after you. Well, this is saying, as dear children of God, let's imitate God. Amen. It's all right then to imitate God. Well, don't the children of the devil act like the devil? I mean, we'll even say that. You're acting like the devil. Children of the devil act like the devil, don't they? And some Christians. I didn't get one amen on that. Were you even listening? We say that person's just acting like the devil, and he's a Christian. Well, if children of the devil can act like the devil, children of God ought to act like God. And God is love. He has power, but he is love. The first attribute that's mentioned is love. They'll know that you're my disciples, Jesus said, because you love. We know that we passed from death unto life because we love. Is that right? The love of God has been shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Ghost. That's love. Well, this says, the next verse says, walk in love, as Christ also hath loved us. So that's our walk. That's what we're to do. And 1 Corinthians 13 is a good place to camp out. It tells us what love is, the nature, the character, the attributes, the characteristics of love. Tells us what love is. Love, verse 4 says, now charity is love. The Greek word is agape. Charity, and it's a giving love. I believe why they translated it charity, and that can be misunderstood, but I believe why they did that is it's a giving love, not a selfish love. Charity suffereth long. Somebody says, yeah, I've done that. I've been suffering a long time. You know how long I've lived with that man? You know how long I've lived with that woman? I've been suffering a long time. Well, this says love is kind. Love suffers long and is kind. And so that's the way that we ought to respond, even when something's not going our way. Love envies not and does not vaunt itself, is not puffed up. Love does not behave itself unseemly. Love seeks not her own. Love is not easily provoked. Didn't say it couldn't be done. Didn't say it couldn't be done, but it's not easy. Didn't say it couldn't be done. I mean, I see Jesus when he's running the money changers out of the temple, but you don't see that as his routine. You know, he got provoked, but it wasn't easy. The Bible tells me in the Old Testament, God is slow to anger. Didn't say it couldn't be done. Amen. Well, love is not easily provoked. Love thinks no evil. Love does not rejoice in iniquity, but it does rejoice in the truth. It'll bear up all things and believe things and hope things and endure things. And then charity, love never fails. Now this means, and this is one of the most misunderstood verses in this passage, maybe in the whole Bible itself, this is a very misunderstood verse. Love never fails. But this is referring to it will never cease to exist. It'll never fade away. In heaven, you'll have the same love that you have right now, because the love you have right now will never cease to exist. That's what this is talking about. Because in context, prophecies will, tongues will. We won't need tongues in heaven. We won't have partial knowledge. In heaven, we'll know even as we are known. Amen. And so this is talking about things that are temporary in this realm, but in heaven, there are some things that are eternal. Well, prophecy, that's going to cease. Tongues, that's going to cease. Partial knowledge, that's going to vanish away. Now we know in part and prophesy in part. So here, these things are temporal. Partial knowledge, partial prophecy, we just see through a glass darkly. That's what it says, verse 12. And that's Paul. If that's Paul, I know that includes me. If he saw through a glass darkly, glass is mirror. Their mirrors weren't clear. You'd look at a mirror and it's not a clear image. Well, I'm looking into the spirit realm, but it's just not a clear image. It's just not clear. But I tell you, in heaven, we'll know even as we are known. Now, some of these same thoughts are in 1 John 3. Now we're the sons of God. Doth not yet appear what we shall be, but we know when he appears, we'll be like him, because we'll see him. We'll see him face to face. Now it's partial. Paul, writing to the Corinthians elsewhere, he said, we're growing from glory to glory. We're looking in as in a glass, the glory of the Lord, and are being changed into his image from glory to glory. He wrote that elsewhere to the Corinthians. And so he's using the term glass again, mirror. This working or walking with God is like looking into the Word of God, and as you're in the fellowship of the Spirit of God, in prayer, in fellowship, you're prayerfully fellowshipping with the Lord, and looking into the Word of God. He said, it's like looking into the things of God, Jesus Christ. He's the Word made flesh, and this is his Word. That's 2 Corinthians 3. 2 Corinthians 3, the last verse. He said, it's like we're looking at him in a mirror. With open face, beholding as in a glass. Glass there means mirror. I'm looking into the Word of God, and I come into his service, or I listen on YouTube or an MP3 or something, a CD, and I'm listening to a message. I'm in a service listening to a message, or I'm with my earphones on or in the car or wherever at home listening to a message, or I'm reading the Word of God. Well, I'm in the fellowship of the Spirit. It needs to be with the right attitude. You won't get anything if you don't have the right attitude, even reading his Word, or a book about him, or listening to a message about him. You won't get anything if you don't have the right spiritual attitude. The carnal man doesn't get the things of God. Is that right or not? So we're with open face, beholding, just like you would in a mirror, the glory of the Lord. And we're changed into that same image. But see, here it's from glory to glory, it's progressive. It's from glory to glory, it's progressive. That's why Paul could say, we're looking into this mirror, but we see it unclear. We're looking through a glass darkly, or an unclear image. One translation says, as in a riddle. But then John, in 1 John 3, he's saying some of the same things. Well, when he appears, we'll see him face to face. Well, when you see him face to face, you don't need the mirror anymore. The mirror is his image. But we, right here in this realm, while we're on this earth, it's just partial. The mirror is him. It's his image. We're seeing the image of the Lord the way we would look in a mirror. When you look in a mirror, don't you see an image? You see your image, don't you? Anybody look at a mirror today? Anybody in this room look at a mirror today? Did you see my image? No, when I look at a mirror, I see my image. You look at a mirror, you see your image. But when we're looking at the mirror of God, we see the image of Jesus Christ. And this difference between his mirror and our natural mirror, the natural mirror conforms to you. Whatever image is put in front of it, it'll conform to that image. I can look at your mirror and it'll conform to me. You can look at my mirror and my mirror will conform to you. But when we look at God's mirror, it's his intention that we conform to him. Yeah. We're changed, but here it's progressive from glory to glory. It's progressive. We see through a glass darkly, but the more we stay in his presence, the fellowship of his spirit, listening to his word, reading his word, and in the fellowship of his spirit, we're changed into his image from glory to glory. But when he appears, you don't need the mirror anymore. The mirror is his image, but we see through a glass darkly. But when he appears, you won't need the mirror anymore. Because the mirror is removed and his face is in front of you. And you see his full face and you see the full glory. And you're changed in a moment in the twinkling of an eye into his image. Amen. That's what this is talking about. So 1 John 3 is talking about when he appears. Verse 2. We're the children of God right now. It's not something that's going to happen one day in the sweet by and by. We're children of God right now because we have the life of God right now. And that life is eternal life. And so we're the children of God right now, but it doesn't yet appear what we shall be. That hadn't happened yet. That's progressive. It doesn't yet appear what we shall be, but we know that when he appears, we'll be like him. Now why? We'll see him as he is. And if you couple that, 1 John 3, with 1 Corinthians 13, we'll see him as he is. But 1 Corinthians 13 says we'll see him face to face. We'll see him face to face. We'll see him as he is, and we'll see him face to face. Verse 12, 1 Corinthians 13, 12. We see through a glass darkly, but then we'll see him face to face. Well, the mirror is removed, and his face is in its place, and we'll see him face to face. And now we don't see through a glass darkly, we see him. We see that's eternal. That life is eternal. Right now, we know in part. Right now, we prophesy in part. Right now, we even see spiritual things just partially. But the life we have is eternal, and the love we have is eternal. That love will never cease to exist, though knowledge will cease, tongues will cease, prophecies will cease. The love will never cease. So when it says love will never fail, love never fails, it's talking about fade away or cease to exist. That's what it means. That's what it means. That's what it means. That's what it means. Well, you know, love will never fail. Well, I notice God loves the world and they don't all come to him. Just walk in love. You know, love will never fail. Well, there's some things you ought to do. You ought to walk in love and you'll have more success doing that otherwise. But that's not what that verse means. That's not what that verse means. Well, you know, love will never fail. Just love him. He'll submit. Just love her. She'll submit. Well, I notice God loves the world, and they're not all submitting. That's not what that verse means. Now, love is a better way to go than otherwise. But you can love people, and they won't all get it. Is that an amen or not? Amen. Now, it's better than the otherwise. You should pray for your enemies. You should do them good. The Bible teaches that. Is that right? And you should love them, and you should pray for them, and you should do them good. And if they're hungry, you feed them. And if you're thirsty, you give them drink. And the latter part of Romans chapter, I believe it's Romans chapter 12, talks about that. And so these are the right things to do. But it doesn't mean they will always respond correctly, even though you do the right thing. It doesn't mean they'll always do the right thing. How many can say amen to that? Amen. You should do the right thing, but that doesn't mean they'll always do the right thing because I'm accountable to God and he wants me to walk in love and he wants me to forgive and he wants me to pray and he wants me to do good, but that doesn't mean everybody's going to respond correctly. In fact, Romans 12, I wanted to turn to that because I'm quoting at it. It says, if your enemy's hungry, feed him. He's your enemy now. It's easy to feed your friends. If he's thirsty, give him drink. This is your enemy now. For in so doing, you'll heap coals of fire on his head. And somebody said, yeah, that's what I want to do. There's a pastor asked a lady one time, he thought she knew what he meant. She was talking about how the husband had been treating her. And so the pastor asked and said, well, have you tried heaping coals of fire on his head? And she said, no, but I poured scalding water on him. But heaping coals of fire on his head is an idiom that refers to the Old Testament, that it's a blessing. It's like their fireplace that they're carrying on their head going to the next campsite or the next place where they're going to spend the night. And that was their sustenance. That was their life. They're carrying their coals of fire on their head. Now, if it's in the cool of the day, it keeps them warm. But that's their sustenance when they get to the place where they're going to camp that night. They're going to use these coals, and they're going to rekindle them, and that's their fire. And so this is a blessing. I think one translation even says hot love, heaping hot love on their head. Now, whose head? Your enemy. That's what love will do. It doesn't mean they'll always respond correctly, but it'll keep your heart right, because verse 21 is a key verse. Don't let evil overcome you. Overcome the evil with the good. Now, that is more in you than in them, because you can pray for your enemy and it'll do you more good than it will your enemy. It may or may not help your enemy, but it will always help you. It may or may not help your enemy, but it will always help you. When you pray for your enemy and you want to do them good, instead of, this says, vengeance is mine, saith the Lord. Verse 19, it'd be good to read all of this in context. In fact, let's read we won't right now, but you could read all of chapter 12. In fact, you could read all of Romans. In fact, you could read the whole New Testament. But verse 18 says, if it's possible. He might have been around some of your relatives sometime, because he didn't say it's always possible. But if it is, if it's possible, as much as lieth in you, live peaceably with all men. He means you do your part. Maybe they won't respond, but you do as much as you can to keep the peace. Dearly beloved, avenge not yourselves. Give place unto wrath, for it's written, vengeance is mine, I will repay, saith the Lord. Am I going to repay? No, God will. God knows how to take care of this. God knows how to take care of this. I'm going to pray for them, do them good. As much as I can, live at peace with them and do them good. Let God handle it. Amen. So when you do that, that's how if you want to say love never fails, well, that doesn't mean they'll always respond. What it means, love will never cease to exist. Even though you understand the meaning of that, that still doesn't mean you shouldn't go ahead and walk in love. Well, love will never fail. That means it'll never cease to exist, but you still go ahead and walk in love. It may produce results, it may not, but for them, it'll always produce results in you. So, 1 Corinthians 13 then is talking about this love, the giving kind of love, charity. And I like it in the Amplified. Verse 4, in the Amplified, charity suffereth long and is kind. But in the Amplified, its love endures long and is patient and kind. Love never is envious nor boils over with jealousy. Is not boastful or vainglorious. Now that does not mean that you cannot give a testimony of how God's using you or working through you. I mean, if that's true, then Jesus was the opposite of this when he said, the Spirit of the Lord's upon me, he's anointed me. Somebody said, you're just bragging now. No, he's wanting the people to believe it so he can help the people. Some minister talk about the anointing of God on him, and some devil-inspired comment will be, well, he's just bragging now. Can somebody say amen? I'm trying to be nice. That's not this. You're not being boastful. You're wanting people to believe what God's. When Peter, Peter and John in Acts chapter 3, on their way to the temple, the hour of prayer being the ninth hour, and there's that man laid daily asking alms. And Peter, fastening his eyes on him with John, said, "Look on us. Look on us." "Oh, you're just bragging now. You mean look on Jesus, don't you?" "Know, I didn't stutter. I said, look on us." Well, at our church, we always say, look to Jesus. If you've got something from God, be bold about it. Give him the glory, but you go ahead and be bold about it. Amen. How can people believe it if you don't tell them what you have? Amen. And sure, the devil will criticize you, and he'll use people to do it. I've been there. I've got that T-shirt. Oh, yeah. Can somebody say amen? Look on us. Well, you mean look on Jesus. You can cloak that feigned humility all you want to, but if you've got something from God, you ought to be bold about it. Amen. They're not being boastful or vainglorious. They're trying to get the man to receive his healing. Amen. And yet some devil-inspired comment will be critical. He's just bragging. She's just bragging. You know what the Bible says. You're not supposed to be boastful. Well, that couldn't be what that means, or Peter and John were wrong. It couldn't be what that means, or Jesus was wrong. When Jesus said, "Do you believe that I'm able to do this?" And they said, "Yea, Lord." Is that right or not? Matthew 9:28, he asked those two blind men, "Do you believe that I'm able to do this?" And they said, "Yea, Lord." So that's not what this means. You ought to be able to tell people, you know, God uses me in a certain area, and if I pray for you, will you believe it? Will you receive it? Amen. But the one that's all the time trying to attract attention to himself for his own purpose, for his own agenda, for his own ulterior motive, may not always be ulterior. Then that's what this is talking about. Does not display itself haughtily. It is not conceited, arrogant, inflated with pride. It is not rude, unmannerly, does not act unbecomingly. Love, God's love in us. So this is talking about our love, but God's love in us. So the us ought to be understood. It's how you live. It's how you walk. It's how you talk. It's how you act and react. Because the us ought to be understood. This isn't God apart from you. This is God's love in you. Does not insist on its own rights or its own way. It is not self-seeking. It is not touchy or fretful or resentful. Now here's a good one. Takes no account of the evil done to it. Pays no attention to a suffered wrong. Now that doesn't mean you don't have some counsel sometimes, but godly counsel ought to be looking for a way to answer the solution, find the solution, solve the problem, find the answer, instead of tear somebody down while you're doing it. I mean, the spirit of godly counsel is looking for the answer, and it'll be considering the other person and with love. This person did me wrong. Godly counsel wants to find how to respond to that and walk in love toward the other person too. And if they won't change, sometimes you ought to respond to that. "Well, I've tried. Well, here's the answer. You just need to get away because it looks like they're going to tear you down if you don't. But you're not trying to hurt their reputation while you talk about this." Somebody say amen. Pays no attention to a suffer wrong doesn't mean you stay there and let them beat you all to smithereens. Couldn't mean that. Or else, why is Paul letting himself be let down out of the city in a basket when he found out they were persecuting him? He's trying to get away from it. Well, just walk in love, Paul. Let them just tear you up. No, I'm going to try to get away from that. Can somebody say amen? So, but I'm not going to talk about it. I mean, one lady came to me. I picked her up for church. Me and Susan went to her. She's a first-time visitor. She had called the church and said she wanted to come and she needed a ride. So I said, "Well, my wife and I can come pick you up." And she got her address. And so we went to pick her up and brought her to church for the first time. On the way to church now, she started to talk about the neighbor because we pulled in the driveway she picked up. And she started to talk about the neighbor that was to the right of her driveway. Started to talk about something that happened to her, that neighbor did to her. Well, this first-time visitor, I mean, if she'll keep coming, she'll hear teaching on love. She'll hear teaching on forgiveness. She'll hear some teaching if she keeps coming. But first time. And Susan remembers this, right? And so we pull out of the driveway. We head down the road. She starts talking about this neighbor, what this neighbor did to her, what this neighbor did to her, what this neighbor did to her. How horrible is this neighbor? Oh, you don't know what it's like. Oh, you don't know what it's like living with this neighbor. So I just, after she went on for a while, and we're getting closer to the church now, I just stopped her and said, "Sister, when did this happen?" You know, she's making it sound like maybe it was last week. 20. I said, "When did this happen?" She said, "Let me think. 20 years ago. 20 years ago." I said, "This happened 20 years ago?" And she just wants everybody to hear how, I mean, I know I'm not the only one she's told this story to. So she's wanting everybody to hear what this neighbor did, you know, any ear she can find, because somehow it makes her feel good to tell everybody how she has been wronged by this neighbor 20 years ago. I get around people, they want to talk about how they were wronged, how they were brought up, what happened in their childhood, and they want to go on and on and on. And I think, well, after they hear some teaching, if they keep coming to the church, they'll learn to stop doing that. And sometimes they don't ever stop doing that. They keep talking about how they were wronged when they were something. You know, 30, 40, 50 years ago, and they just keep dredging that back up. Well, that's what this is talking about. Takes no account of the evil done to it. That's what this is talking about. Pays no attention. There's the place where love says, "I'm just going to let that go. I forgive them." And forgiveness means I wipe it clean. It's as if they didn't do it. Now, that doesn't mean if somebody wrecks my car, I'll loan them another one. That doesn't mean that if somebody comes in and abuses the children, we forgive them and put them over the nursery. Come on now. I can walk in love, but I still have enough sense to know when someone can't be trusted. So there's a difference between wisdom and just a blind love and a blind trust. Sometimes when trust is lost, it has to be earned. Is that right or not? So that's not what this is talking about. This is talking about the attitude of your heart, that you're not harboring the grudge. And when you talk about it, the venom is dripping from your lips afresh. Can somebody say amen? I told a lady one time, the pastor's wife, they forgot I was in the room. I was preaching in their church, and then after the meetings were over, they had scheduled other meetings in other churches. And they said, "You just continue to stay here while you're going to the other churches." So I'm living with them for a little while, preaching in other churches where they had helped set it up. And I'm across the room, sitting in the room, and they're all the way across the other room, and they started to talk about one of their church members and tearing the church member to pieces. Because, bless her heart, somebody had hurt the pastor's wife, hurt her feelings. And she's just tearing, and he's agreeing. They're tearing this couple as a couple, husband and wife in their church, that something was said somewhere along the line that hurt the pastor's wife's feelings. And then she looked across the room at me. She'd forgotten I was even in the room. And she said, "Oh, Brother Tony, what do you think about all this?" And this is something like 30, 35 years ago before I'd learned some things about keeping my mouth shut. And I said this, I said, "Sometimes you have to discuss things in the spirit of counsel. Something like this ought to be discussed. Something happens in the church, some things need to be discussed in the spirit of counsel. But you shouldn't have venom dripping from your lips while you do it." They never had me back. You talk about, they as much as put me out. I mean, they did let me stay while I was finishing the meetings, but they never had anything to do with me ever again. You shouldn't have venom dripping from your lips. Well, I wish I'd kept my mouth shut and made sure it was by the Spirit of God. Now, if he prompts me to speak, I'll go ahead and do it. But I didn't get any prompting. I just did that on my own, and it didn't work out well. Sometimes it doesn't work out well anyway, but at least you know the Spirit of God prompted you. I'm more confident in that these days. Sometimes it still doesn't work out, but you're confident that the Spirit of God prompted you. But that day I was not confident. That was about 40 years ago. Well, that's talking about you can discuss some things, but you're not harboring the grudge. Love doesn't take account the evil. It pays no attention to the suffered wrong. That means you're not harboring the grudge. And if you were to discuss it in the atmosphere of godly counsel, you're not venom isn't dripping from your lips as you recall the memory of that hurt. Love won't do that. Love's not all the time wanting to talk about what was done wrong to it. Now, some things ought to be discussed. Sometimes people need to have repair done. Be encouraged and re-encouraged. All right, that person put you down, but you are worthwhile. They called you worthless. You're not. And you repair some things, and they need to have some restoration in their own spirit. Can somebody say amen? That's not what this is talking about. This is talking about where you want to tear somebody down. Let me tell you what my neighbor did. When was that? 20 years ago. And the whole thing is to tear that neighbor down. And she's feeling good while she's doing it. Well, love won't do that. And then it does not rejoice at injustice and unrighteousness, even when it's your enemy that did it. Well, they got caught up into that. Good enough for them. Love won't do that. Love doesn't rejoice even when someone receives repercussions for their own actions. Did you hear me? Well, good enough for them. They made their bed, let them lie in it. Love actually would want them to come to their senses and get out of the snare of the devil. Amen. Love would want them to come to repentance. Well, maybe they never will. Maybe they never have and never will. But love would want them to. Doesn't rejoice at injustice. Even if injustice occurs and there's unrighteousness and the fruits of their unrighteousness prevails. Love rejoices when right and truth prevail. Love bears up under anything and everything that comes. Is ever ready to believe the best of every person. Its hopes are fadeless under all circumstances, and it endures everything without weakening. And then love never fails, never fades out, or becomes obsolete, or comes to an end. All right, amen. And then faith works by love. Is God's love in us, but we're responding to it. Somebody said, I just believe that's our faith in God, knowing God loves us. But you remember the story where Jesus talked about a friend, lend me 3 loaves for a friend of mine in his journey has come. And he said, I can't because the children are in bed. The doors are locked and shut up and we're all in bed. I can't get up and rise. And Jesus, now this is Luke 11. Jesus said he won't get up because he's a friend. He wouldn't go away. I can't get up. We're all locked up in bed. You know, the doors are locked. We're all in bed. We're all shut in for the night. I can't get up. This is Luke 11 now. I can't get up. Verse 7, trouble me not. The door's shut. Children are with me in bed. I cannot rise and give you. And Jesus is talking about prayer. This is a comparison between you and your heavenly Father. This is a comparison. Jesus is talking about prayer. And sometimes it seems that your prayers aren't being heard or answered. Can somebody say amen? Amen. This is talking about you and your prayer life with God. Because he's given this parable. They said, teach us to pray. And he didn't finish the thought. This is what we call the Lord's Prayer. And then he's still talking about prayer. You know, teach us to pray. And he gave what we call the Lord's Prayer, but he didn't finish his thought. He's still talking about prayer. So my prayer life before God, when it seems like the answer is no, it seems like he's not responding, Jesus is saying, stay with it. Stay with it. Don't give up. Don't quit. Stay with it. And he gave this parable. This guy goes to the neighbor and says, lend me 3 loaves. And he wouldn't do it, but he stayed with it. He stayed with it. He stayed with it. And it says importunity. Verse 8 says importunity, which means boldness without any shame or embarrassment. I'm going to stay with it even if I wake up the whole neighborhood. Amen. I'm not going away without. And Jesus is talking about prayer. Now, I want you to notice Jesus said he won't get up because he's a friend. You can read that right there. Verse 8, he won't give up, get up and give him. He will not rise and give him. He will not rise and give him because he's a friend. Well, I know God loves me. He's going to bless me. He will not because he loves you. But he will when you operate in faith, because the Bible says, ask in faith, nothing wavering. Well, God loves me. He's going to take care of me. Then Jesus is confused when he gave this parable because he said he won't based on the relationship of being a friend. But he will based on your importunity. And God's a rewarder of those that diligently seek him. It doesn't say God's a rewarder of those he loves. In fact, there's two people that came to Jesus, heard his sayings. One did them, one didn't do them. God loved both of them. And the one that didn't do them, the storm came. The stream beat. Is that right? And great, immediately that house fell, and great was the fall. Great was the destruction. God loved him anyway. But he had great destruction. I go to a restaurant and I order something. And a little bit, that waitress brings it. I never think to myself, oh, how that waitress loves me. I just expected the waitress to keep her word or the waiter to keep his word. I expected that. It wasn't based on love. It was based on the word. You want a glass of water? I do. I'll bring you one. I expect that. Why? Because their word's good. Now, people do forget. God never does. God's word is always good. We sometimes forget, make mistakes. But when the person brings it to me, I never do think one moment, oh, how that waiter loves me. Did you notice how that waiter just gave me what I asked? Must be he loves me. Keep his word. Well, God keeps his word. When I believe his word, God keeps his word. Amen. Well, faith works by love couldn't mean God's going to do for me because he loves me, or else these things are confusing. In fact, Jesus said in Mark 11, 24, what things soever you desire, when you pray, makes no difference what you believe, God loves you. Is that what it says? What things soever you desire, when you pray, just tell God about it. I mean, Matthew 21, verse 22. Matthew 21, verse 22. All things, whatsoever you shall ask for in prayer, you'll receive it. God loves you. Did I leave a word out? Matthew 21, 22. And all things, whatsoever you shall ask for in prayer. What's the next word? Believing. What's the next word? Believing. See, that's an important word. If I'll believe it and stand my ground. Cast not away my confidence. Hold fast to the profession of my faith. Don't get weary in well-doing. And then faith works by love. Whose love? Well, it couldn't be God's love, or that's inconsistent with these other scriptures. But I tell you what is consistent. Mark 11, 24, what things serve you desire when you pray, believe that you receive them and you'll have them. And the next verse, when you stand, pray and forgive. See, verse 25 goes with verse 24. Verse 25 goes with verse 24. I said verse 25 goes with verse 24. So if I'm walking in forgiveness and walking in love while I'm praying this kind of faith prayer that believes it receives when it prays, then I can have the confidence that it'll come. And that's how faith works. Faith works by this kind of lifestyle. And when you realize you miss it, you say, Father, forgive me. When you realize that you're responding differently than how love would respond, you say, Father, forgive me. And thank God for the precious blood. I said, thank God for the precious blood. Confess your sin. He's faithful and just to forgive and to cleanse from all unrighteousness. Lord, that wasn't the right thing for me to say. That wasn't the right thing for me to do. That wasn't the right way for me to act. Father, forgive me. And my faith is intact. Because in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, he forgives me and cleanses me. And then I'm just going to walk that way and talk that way and act that way. And if other people watch and think that's arrogant, fine. I'm just going to go on and walk with God and believe I receive. And he's faithful when I stand, pray, and forgive. Well, that must mean there's something to forgive. If there is anything to forgive. He said, if there's anything, small or large, anything, when you stand praying, forgive. And that's alt. Alt means anything, and that's little or big. Something small, something large, doesn't matter what it is, I'm going to forgive. And that'll make sure that my faith is working. When you stand praying, forgive if you have anything against anybody. Because faith works by love. Can somebody say amen? Well, that's what that means. Faith works by love. It's not God's love as much as my walking in love and acting that way. Amen. Well, when I know that, then make sure that the lifestyle is consistent. I don't want to have any critical words. The Bible says in Psalm chapter 1, blessed are those that will not sit in the seat of the scornful. So I don't want to sit in that seat. I don't want to have any words of scorn or criticism or fault finding or talking. You know, but see, people are around me and Susan, but they don't see what you don't do. And they don't hear what you don't say. But if somebody gets involved with tearing somebody else down, we don't participate. Well, they did wrong. Again, some things ought to be discussed in the spirit of godly counsel, but venom shouldn't be dripping from your lips. Something should be discussed for the purpose of repair and restoration. Lift people up. All right, they put you down. I'm going to come along and lift you up. Get you past this. They tore you down. I'm going to lift you up. But let's forgive them and go on. Can somebody say amen? Amen. And so then you don't spread it around for everybody. Godly counsel should be with the person that's helping you repair. It's not just anybody on the phone. Well, let me tell you. Amen. And so, when other people are getting involved, they want to talk about somebody, what somebody did. Well, I don't know their heart. I don't know why they did it. You know, you hear about a minister that's doing a certain thing. What do you think about that, Brother Tony? Well, I can't follow that. And so Susan brought that up. About the most he'll ever say is, I can't follow that. Does he ever say anything critical about him? No. I believe that's one reason we've walked in some things for 45 years. And see, this group, when I said most Christians walk beneath their rights and privileges and most Christians do not live in the supernatural, I had their attention. And then she interrupted me and said, we don't hear teaching like this. Well, if you want your faith to work, you've got to walk in love. Now, grow in faith. You've got to feed and meditate and keep it rekindled. But it still won't work if the love's not right. And then you've got to have corresponding action. Somebody says, I have faith. Somebody else says, James said, well, you say you have faith, but just watch how I live. Because faith that doesn't do something is dead. So you can watch how we live. Well, when I got bit by the spiders three times, or three spiders one time, I think it was one spider three times. What do you think, honey? Was it three spiders? Might have been three spiders. And I lost all of my breath. I lost 80% of my breathing ability instantly. And I just commanded that to go in Jesus' name. And a little bit, I could breathe a little better. I got better and better and better. Came in, we were doing yard work. That's how I got bit. I'm where the spiders are. And got bit three times. I felt it. Ouch, ouch, ouch. On my back. And then I let her look at me later, and there are three big whelps. I mean, three big whelps on my back. Red, splotch, big. She said, something got you. And I said, well, I know it. I never did tell her I couldn't breathe. Somebody asked me later, why didn't you go to the urgent care? And it dawned on me. I never thought of that. It never even crossed my mind. You know, they could have given you a shot. Maybe they could have. I never even thought of it. Never even crossed my mind that a shot's just to drive away. Because what did cross my mind was talking to it in Jesus' name and it'll work. And that's what, see, that's how we live. When she got bit and she came inside with a swollen foot, she said, Tony, look at my foot. I put my hand on it and the swelling went down almost instantly. I said, what got you? She said, I don't know. She's out doing yard work. Her foot or her ankle was a good 50% larger than it's supposed to be, almost twice maybe, twice the size of a normal foot. I said, something got you. What got you? She said, I don't know, but something did. She sat down in the chair, and I knelt down at her feet, put my hand on it. I command this to go in Jesus' name. Father, thank you for your word. Thank you for your healing. Went down under my hand. And that's just a couple of few years ago, 2-3 years ago. That's how we live. And the reason the faith works, so that's the action, but that's not even going to work. I mean, faith has companions, and I told them this. Faith has companions. I sometimes refer to it as an antenna sticking up in the air. Faith is the antenna sticking up, but it's held up by a three-legged tripod. The three legs of the tripod are important to get the faith sticking up. Faith sticking up in the air, but it's an antenna on a three-legged tripod. And any one of those legs will cause the faith to fall over if you remove it. You can't have 2 out of 3 and it still be good. 2 out of 3 is good. No, it's not. The whole tripod will fall over. Well, 2 out of 3 ain't bad. 2 out of 3 ain't going to work. That tripod's going to tip over if you remove any one of those three legs. Faith is the antenna sticking up in the air. But number one, and most importantly, it has to operate by love. Number two, and very important, you've got to mix it with praise and thanksgiving. And then three, maybe just as important, is that has to be mixed with patience. When something is not instant, you stand your ground. And James talked about that, having done all. Stand. Well, Paul said that, but James said, let patience have a perfect work. Hebrews 10:35 says, cast not away your confidence, has great recompense of reward. The next verse says, you have need of patience. So patience is important, praise and thanksgiving. I mix those together. It's two words, but it's all one action. Praise and thanksgiving. And then love. You've got to have those three to hold your faith up in the air. Faith works by love. It's mixed with praise and thanksgiving. And it has to be working with patience. The spider bites. That was an instant. That was a Saturday. I spent some of the nights sleepless because my lungs weren't working. And I'd have to use muscles to push my lungs. It's hard to go to sleep when you're pushing your lungs to breathe. You start to doze off to sleep, and then you wake back up because you're not breathing. But I finally dozed off, and everything was normal. 6 o'clock in the morning, came over here on a Sunday morning, nobody knew anything happened. I'd only had an hour and a half, 2 hours of sleep. But nobody could tell until I gave the testimony. But that's how we live. Her heart wasn't beating. She said, Tony, feel my heart. Because they asked me, one of the questions was, well, do you pray? And I said, you know, if something, you know, you wake up in the morning and one of you is moving kind of slow. And I said, we don't talk about it. I look at Susan, Susan looks at me, and maybe she's moving slow. Maybe I'm moving slow. We don't talk about it. It never comes out of my mouth. Honey, how do you feel? I don't remember the last time I asked her how she felt. Seriously. I mean, we tease, but not seriously. So when one person said, well, do you pray? You know, you see your wife moving kind of slow. Do you pray for her? And I said, not often. I don't mention it. If you're going to mention it in prayer, you're mentioning it. You're walking by faith, not by sight. I'm thanking you, Lord, for strength. Don't mention the weakness. Lord, thank you for strength today. The Lord is the strength of my heart. The Lord is the strength of my life. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. You don't mention the other. Amen. Not even in prayer. I've seen people fail that do this. But then I did say when she came in and she said, Tony, feel my heart, I prayed then. Because it's the difference. Some things are serious, more serious than other things. And then I also brought up, you don't use the word if. If can be, it reveals doubt. You don't look and see, and I'll bring up this in a moment. You can look to see that something's working. What is the progress? You know, her ear took 18 months. Well, I'd look at it to see the progress, but I never looked at it to see if it was okay. Amen. You better watch it. Took 18 months. Well, I'm looking at her ear, but I'm looking to see the progress. I'm not looking to see if it's working. You better watch it. As soon as you use that word if, you reveal doubt. Sounds like semantics. You go by what you think it sounds. It's important. It may be a nuance of an understanding, but it's important. I'm looking to see the progress. I'm not looking to see if it's working. I believe it is working. I believe it's working. Now I want to look at the progress. First the blade, then the ear. After that, the full corn in the ear. Let's look at the progress. She said, Tony, feel my heart. I put my hand on her chest and I said, it's not beating. It's just vibrating, just quivering. So I said, I told them that testimony. I said, then we prayed. I said, come on, honey, lay down. We're going to pray. I'm going to lay my hand upon you. We're going to pray and praise the Lord for the healing. I'm going to command that to leave you and be normal. And we're just going to praise the Lord for it and thank God for it. And then we started to get rested and doze off to sleep. Well, the thought came to my mind, if you go to sleep, you wake up, she's going to be dead. You're going to go to sleep and wake up and she'll be dead. You better look at her and see if she's breathing. And I wouldn't do it. Why don't you look at her and see if she's breathing? I had these thoughts in my mind. I'm having a conversation with the devil in my mind. Look at her and see if she's breathing. I said, I won't do it. I stiffened my neck. I actually stiffened my neck. I'm not going to budge. I'm not going to look at her to see if she's breathing. Give me a break. Not going to do it. You're not going to look at her? I absolutely am not going to look at her. Not to see if she's breathing. I like to look at her. But I'm not going to see if she's dead or not. I don't believe that. Not even going to check it out. I don't believe it. I'm going to act on what I believe. What I do believe is she's fine. So I'm going to act that way and I'm going to go to sleep. We both went to sleep, woke up, every symptom was gone, never came back. Now that time we prayed. Amen. They want to say, what do you do when you go to the doctor? I said, as much as possible, talk in the past tense. I've been dealing with. I had their attention. I've been dealing with these symptoms. As much as you can, talk in the past tense. Don't reestablish by making it present tense. And then I said, you know, this is difficult sometimes because people in their home, they're not always with other family members that talk faith. And they'll pull at you. You're around other people in your house that talk doubt and unbelief, and that they'll pull at you. But the problem is the tongue. When Jesus raised Jairus' daughter from the dead, he said, she's asleep. When he raised Lazarus from the dead, Jairus' daughter, what did I say? Jairus' daughter, and then Lazarus. He's asleep. And the King James says he's dead, but that's not what he said. In the Greek, it's he has died. Lazarus is dead. John 11, Lazarus is dead. It doesn't say that. Even the King James translators didn't know faith. Because somebody there, while they're translating it, you know, the King James translators, they could have said, you know, this really says Lazarus has died. And the other one has said, what's the difference? If he's died, he's dead. It's a big difference. It's a big difference. But even people who know Greek may not know faith. The translation could be wrong. We've translated it. Lazarus is dead. You look at it in the Greek and other translations, it doesn't say that. It says he's died. Oh, that's the same thing. No, it's not. Jesus wouldn't establish the present. Amen. And when you get to that place where your tongue does not establish the present in any negative way, you'll walk more in the victory of God. God's not nervous. Something happens, it doesn't make him nervous. He's not full of fear when something happens. He's not moved by the doctor's report when it's negative. The doctor's report doesn't give him fear. Well, the doctor says, I've got cancer. Well, take God's report. Do something about it. Deal with it. Turn your face to the wall. Feed your faith. Get active. Get aggressive. But don't have a bit of fear about it. Amen. That'll try to come, won't it? But you resist that. No, I'm not going to have fear. I'm going to have faith in God's word. This is the outcome. If you'll do that, you'll have the outcome. God's not nervous about it. God, did you read this doctor's report? They say, I have cancer. God goes, oh my. What am I going to do now? That's serious. You know those doctors know their business. No. You choose what report you're going to believe. You do something about it to change it. Hezekiah turned his face to the wall, but not motivated by fear. Not motivated by some, I'm gonna get right with God. And then the situation changes and they fall right back into their backslidden condition all over again. Now, if they do actually turn and stay, that's a good thing. But most of the time, it doesn't happen. Can somebody say amen? Well, we want to continue to grow in these things and to have examples. This is my prayer. I think about what's written in Hebrews 6:12. Don't be slothful, that is, don't be lazy. But it says to be followers of them who through faith and patience inherit the promises. Well, if that's what this is saying, I want to be one of them that can be followed. Amen. Why do I want to inherit the promises? Why do I want to inherit the promises? Number of reasons to give glory to God. I tell you, way down there on the list, way down there, somewhere on the list, it might be there, but it's way down on the list for my own benefit. You know, so I'll feel better. No. Higher on the list than that is so I can be the right example. Because this says follow. Well, I want to be what somebody can follow. That so, Lord, and I've prayed this prayer I've just revealed to you what one of the prayers I pray in secret. Lord, help me to have testimonies that bring you glory and can be a good example for others to follow. Can somebody say amen? Amen.